to multiply the services so that we can allow everybody an opportunity to get in. We have been having 3 to 5 services a Sunday, so it becomes a little bit more difficult when you have to fit the 8 o'clock, the 10 o'clock, the 12 o'clock, and the 6 o'clock service into these two services. So we have already 5 overflow rooms. So we want to bless the Lord for every person that is in every last one of those overflow rooms. We bless the Lord for you tonight. Come on, put your hands together for Global Destiny all over the campus. Come on, put your hands together. KTN, all of the overflow rooms in this building and next door, we honor the Lord for his goodness and his mercy toward us. Amen, somebody. We want to bless the Lord again for Sister Regina. He's going to work in your favor. My God. We just honor the Lord for the man of God, for Bishop. Just put your hands together for Bishop again. Doing a tremendous work. Amen. May you be seated in his presence. You have an individual that, matter of fact, this month, coming January after 12 o'clock, will be our 1-year anniversary. And I think it is phenomenal that we have to go to 4 services in 1 year's time. God is faithful. Amen, somebody. And you ought to put your hands together to see. And many of you haven't seen all over this campus as what God has allowed Bishop Weeks to accomplish in 1 year is greater than most in many years. So I think he deserves another hand clap for his administrative abilities to accomplish what God has allowed him to accomplish. I'm so happy to be here tonight and to see all of you here. We're going to go right into the word of the Lord tonight. Just going through some things, and I'm telling you, it's been a very, very, very heavy, heavy prayer day today, and just wanting to make sure that we are doing all of what God has called us to do. We are living right now in a very serious time, people of God. And even in my prayer time and just meditating before the Lord today, I just kept really feeling the weight and the seriousness of what is about to be established in the body of Christ, and just making sure with everything that is within me that I am on target. Amen, somebody. Get your Bibles if you would. And you can turn your Bibles with me to Usher. I'm going to allow you to bring Sister Ty down here and whoever she has with her just this one time. One of my spiritual daughters, we ain't special over here. Amen, somebody. If she hadn't came from out of town, she'd be sitting right back there in the overflow room somewhere. But I'm going to permit it this time for her to, brother, who's sitting there? Y'all move over. Come down there. We don't do special seats and all that here. Amen, somebody. Amen. I want you to turn with me to the book of Romans, and I want to remind you of seeking God for 7 days. I want to bless the Lord for all the people that came from Washington, and I'm encouraging all of us to pursue this week. Sister Tanya Hall was supposed to be coming. She won't be able to make it, so I will be ministering Wednesday through Saturday and preaching those nights, those 7 o'clock services. And God has really been dealing with me very strongly, so I'm not really trying to excite you tonight. I just want you to understand what the Lord is speaking for us, because not only as a prophet of God, but as the mother, the spiritual mother of this house, I have to make sure. And these are the things that God is dealing with me about, is making sure that I am raising children that are becoming disciples for Christ. And I mean disciples for real, not just, you know, I was at home and just the presence of the Lord, and I was in the bathroom and I just got overwhelmed at the presence of the Lord, because I just kept saying to the Lord, you know, I have to be sure that I'm not just spinning my wheels. You know, sometimes you're just spinning your wheels and you don't see any manifestation of the growth of God in the people of God. And I just told God, you know, today, Brother Brian, I said, God, I can't do the church thing. And I said, in 2007, I can't do the we got a big church thing. I got to know that these people are understanding the weight of what God has called you into this place to accomplish in your life. Amen, somebody. And not just coming through the door just to be able to say you belong here, but there's going to be a whole nother level of responsibility for your name being on the roll. Because, you know, I look at some of you all and you just hide, just looking at me like, there she go. What is all of that about? God want to get to our bellies. He want to get to our spirits now. He wants us to lose all the fame and all of that and begin to seek him for righteousness. Oh, God, I wish I had a church in here tonight. Looking at me like I'm a, you know, just a gift horse. But that's not the point. The point of it is that how do you feel about God? Are you in love with God? Are you out to please the Lord? And that's where we headed today, to pleasing the Lord. If you turn your Bibles with me to the book of Romans, the first chapter, I'm going to just begin there. And I want you to write three things down that I'm feeling. And then I know that the Lord spoke to me today about where we are and what 2007 will accomplish for us. Number one, 2007 will be the year of the intended purpose. The year of the intended purpose. The year of the intended purpose. Out of all that we are doing, and out of all that we are accomplishing, 2007 would be the year that would put us into the intended purpose of the Lord. What did the Lord intended for us to accomplish? Why were we born? What did the Lord intended for us to accomplish? Hebrews 11, matter of fact, you can write down Romans 1 and 19, but we are already there. Number two, Hebrews 11 and 3 is the intended purpose. Romans 1 and 19, number two, the year of the revealed God. The year of the revealed God. Romans 1 and 19. And the third thing that the Lord spoke to me about 2007. It would be the year of the righteous. It would be the year of the righteous. The year of the righteous. Job 36 and 7 is going to be your cross-reference scripture for that. When you go with me to the book of Romans, the first chapter, and just leaning on some things and looking at what God is trying to say to us, I'm going to read a familiar scripture that I've read before, but for some reason the Lord has taken my spirit back to it. And it says here in Romans 1, from Paul, a bondservant of Jesus Christ, the Messiah, called to be an apostle, a special messenger set apart to preach the gospel, good news of and from God. Ushers, I'm done. You may be seated. Which he promised in advance long ago through his prophets. Somebody said, how was it promised? Through Say, through his prophets. In the sacred scriptures. Somebody say sacred scriptures. And the gospel regarding his son, who as to the flesh, his human nature was descended from David. And as to his divine nature, according to the spirit of holiness, was openly designated the Son of God in power in a striking, triumphant, and miraculous manner by his resurrection from the dead, even Jesus Christ our Lord, the Messiah, the anointed one. It is through him that we have received grace, God's unmerited favor, and our apostleship to promote obedience to the faith and make disciples from his namesake among all the nations. Just laying this foundation. It says, as to his divine nature in the fourth verse, according to the spirit of holiness. Now, when you look at that, I want you to turn with me to the book of 2 Peter. May not shout tonight, but we're going to live. 2 Peter. The first chapter and the third verse. And I want you to keep in mind where it says in the fourth verse of the first chapter of Romans, and as to his divine nature, according to the spirit of holiness. When I looked at this today in just reading it and the things that God began to give me about this subject matter and about the sons and daughters of this ministry and how he began to talk to me about, you have to, you know, the first year we came here and the Lord just led us to come, and we came out of the obedience to the Lord, and we feel like up until this point that we have obeyed the Lord. But we're coming into the second year, and we're coming into the top of the beginning of the year, where the Lord began to say to me, now that we have come here, we have to take on an identification as to what we are all about. You know, sometimes you can't skin a fish until you catch a fish. And you got to catch the fish first before you start scaling the fish. Amen, somebody. And so for the first year, a lot of stuff, you know, you just trying to, you know, get people to come and just love the Lord and the whole nine yards. And so there's no real identification, because people still feel like, you know, well, you know, I'm just coming on, and we just trying, and we just going, you know, do it the best we can. And so the Lord is really dealing with me about the best we can spirit. You know, and he's starting to deal with me about the fact that if the Bible is right, and if his word is true, and if righteousness is right, then there must be a people that the Lord is calling. How do we know that we are in the end times? Come on, somebody. How do we know that we're in the end times? And I know this is, like I said, it's not going to be a popular message, because I know that the tradition of New Year Eve services is to always say it and touch your neighbor and tell your neighbor that God going to pop you out of house this year, and you're going to get a car, and this is going to be your year. This is going to be the year that you're coming out financially. And so what the Lord is saying to me is that this is not the year to come after anything financially. Okay, we getting ready, and I understand what we're saying. I understand about, you know, the multi-million dollar class that Bishop is teaching, and all of that is good, and I'm not in contradiction to that, but you're not going nowhere. You're not going nowhere without righteousness. If God has declared that 2007 is the year of the righteous, then who he's trying to prepare for wealth is the righteous. Because, see, the hand of the Lord in 2007 is raised. The hand of the Lord is raised.
And either it's going to be raised to bless you or slap you. Oh, I'm not hearing nobody talk back to me. Because a lot of stuff that we've gotten away with, we will not be able to get away with it anymore. Because Jesus is on his way back. And those that belong to him, it is time to get your house in order. In order. In order. Every bit, every part of your house in order. Your mind, soul, body, and spirit.
Y'all sit down, because we're going somewhere with this. We're going somewhere with this. It ain't going to be no party. Because first of all, we ain't the world. Ain't nobody talk to me. What we going to do for New Year's and people is partying. And all right. Because I'm after destiny. I'm not trying to, you know. I think some of y'all just totally ignore the whole name that's on the outside of the church. It's global destiny. It's global destiny. It's global destiny. It's global destiny. It's not about your neighborhood. It's not about you. It's about the destiny that you was born to accomplish. And as long as you're not global, you're not accomplishing that, or you in the wrong church. I'm not hearing nobody talk to me right there. It's time for that vision to come open. Because we're talking about global destiny. Then guess what? It's time for me to prepare your heart so that you can be in right standing with God, so you can go to Israel. We're supposed to be sending people all over the nation. We're supposed to be sending people to Russia. We're supposed, from this ministry, raising offerings for you to take off into ministry. But you got to get your spirit ready.
Oh, somebody sit down. We're going to do this. We're going to do this.
I'm not in a hurry, because I got a whole week to preach, so I ain't trying to pop you out nothing. It says that the divine nature of God, take some of the top off of it. The divine nature of God is the spirit of holiness. It is a spirit. And maybe that's why we can't accomplish it, because we're trying to accomplish it as a duty. And it's a spirit. So then why are we doing seeking God for 7 days? We're seeking God for 7 days so that we can be imparted with the spirit to live right. We don't have the spirit to live right. We have information as to how to live, but we don't have the spirit to live right. And when you don't have the spirit to live right, you don't have a power and authority with it. You can't bind the hand of the devil when you don't have the spirit of holiness. Holiness is not just there for you to live right, it's there to give you authority and power. And so 2007, you got to be able to rebuke the devil. Because see, I know people say, well, this is coming and that. No. But what you don't understand is that the closer we get to the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ, and I hate to be the bearer of bad news, but there will be demonic forces that will be released in 2007 that you have never encountered before. I'm not getting nobody to say amen right there. I'm not getting nobody to say amen right there. I'm not getting nobody to say amen right there. I'm not getting nobody to say amen right there. Because see, this is a society, a church society, that's got us looking for houses and cars and stuff and popularity and all of this. And you are completely deceived about what is about to come upon you. And God wants you to be ready. He wants you to be ready with power. He wants you to be ready with authority. He wants you to be able to declare to the devil tonight that I don't care what's coming. I got power over the devil. I have the power to put him under my feet. God, have mercy, Jesus. All I can do today is weep because the Lord just kept dealing with me about my divine nature, my divine nature, my divine nature, and how people don't want my divine nature. They want to come to church to feel better. And see, that's the spirit of the South. As long as I go, then I have accomplished my religious experience for the week. But what God want to do, he want to break you past that. He want to break the spirit of Atlanta off of you. He want to break the spirit of Georgia off of you and get you into the kingdom of God that says it's not enough for me to come to church. I got to have an experience where my belly knows God. My belly knows God. I don't come to church out of duty. I come to church because my spirit knows God. I
come to church because my nature loves him. I come to church because I am in love with him. And that's what's wrong. We don't love him. Oh God, I kept breaking down and weeping while I was getting dressed because I said, God, I said, this week I want you to give me the anointing to impart your love into your people, that they would do what they do for you because they love you. I won't touch it in 2007 because I love him. I won't say that in 2007 because I love him. I won't do that because I love him. We don't love him, Sister Nash. We don't love the Lord. We don't love the Lord. We don't love the Lord. We do what we do for people that we love because we love them. We stay with people. Oh, y'all, I'm not hearing nobody talk to me. How many women of you have stayed with men that have beat you, but you love them? How many of y'all still put up with people that don't do nothing for you because you love them? But what about God? What about God? And every time God begins to tell you what he requires out of you, you complain. Let me show you something. Jesus. Lord Jesus. The divine nature of God in 2 Peter says what? For his, 2 Peter, the first chapter in the third verse. For his divine power. Somebody say his divine power. Has bestowed. Somebody say has. Has bestowed upon us all things that are requisite and suited to life and godliness. Somebody say his divine nature. So then this will be the year of reestablishing what is the divine nature of God and what is your nature. This would be the year of determining whether or not I ever got what I said. And that's what God kept saying to me. He said, you got to go back and make the people begin to reaffirm whether or not they are really saved, or are they just touched? Are they just moved by God? Or have they really been transformed by God? Did God really come in their lives? Or are they operating with the presence of God upon their lives? Because there is a difference. Because when the presence is upon your life, you can walk from under that presence. But when the power of God is in your life, even when you want to walk away, you can't. Oh my God. Oh my God. See, y'all, it's going to be strong. It's going to be strong 2007. I said, it's going to be strong 2007. There's going to be a lot of stuff that I got to say. So you better get your feelings up off your shoulder. See, that's why we got to pump you hard with the praise and worship team. Because you know what? That power is not in you. When that thing gets in you, you can't even barely hear the name of Jesus before it knocks you out of your seat. When the power of God has been birthed in you. Oh, sit down, because I got to. Lord Jesus, let me just. It says his give me some more bottom. His divine power has bestowed upon us all things that are requisite and suited to life and godliness. Which means when that power came in, it equipped me with everything that I needed to live godly. Unless it didn't come in. I hope somebody in the overflow room getting this. Unless it did, because see, listen, you got to be sure. You got to be sure. My job is to be sure. Come on, somebody. I'm not trying to be famous. I gotta make sure you're sure. Do you understand what I'm saying? If I'm called to be responsible for your life, when you lay down and shut your eyes, I got to make sure that I told you what you needed to know to make it into the kingdom. Or the blood is going to be required in my head. It's time to stop playing church. Now, this ain't no play church. The year is over. Oh, come on, somebody. Come on here, somebody. Come on here, somebody. Oh, Jesus, I'm not hearing nobody talk to me right there. Okay. For his divine power has bestowed upon us all things that are requisite and suited to life and godliness through the in there for a minute, that you may escape by flight. You may, because you know what? It's taken too many of us too long to come out of stuff. I'm not hearing y'all talk to me right there. See, some of y'all talking about, well, when is mother coming back? And when is mother? And Bishop is here all the time on Sundays. By I said, well, no, you don't want me here. You think you want me here. You think you want me here. But I'm getting ready to be here. I said it's taking some of y'all too long to put it down. It's taking some of y'all too long to let it go. Who am I talking to right now? Oh, come on. I'm not here to make you shout tonight. Because you know what? I got to take you into the new year with the right spirit. He said when the power of God comes in your belly and it is the divine nature of God, he causes you to escape by flight. That means you come out of it in a hurry. Tell somebody if you ain't out, it's because you don't want to come out. I said sit down and tell your neighbor if you ain't out, it's because you don't want to come out. Tell them it ain't taking God that long. Tell them you got a wavering spirit because the power ain't never hit your belly. Because when the real power of God hits you for real, honey, you don't listen. This thing is a teacher. This thing is a leader to guide us. The Bible said that the Spirit of the Lord will lead you and guide you into all truth. Okay, we sit down because we're gonna handle this right here. Thank you, Jesus. We gotta be a church of power. We gonna close down. I said we gotta be a church of power. We might as well close down. If we gonna be like the people down the street, then why we start another church? Cause God don't need another building. He don't need another group of people. He needs somebody that's willing to be washed in the blood of the Lamb and purged. He's looking for people to live holy for real. And I'm not talking about no mix, oh God. Okay. You know, Bishop and I were under Christmas holiday, and we were at the property in Waycross, and somebody got me some tapes of a pastor in Chicago. And he's an old man that preaches, and he's been preaching for years and years and years. If I called his name, some of you would know who he is. And we were sitting there listening to the tape, and we were all in the kitchen with my mother, my father, a lot of us was in there, and we were watching the DVD. And so when they came on, it was a tape all the way back. I think that tape was 1980-something, 86, I think it was. And he was preaching, and the choir was singing it. And so we were just kind of looking what the choir was singing. But when he got up, Pastor Jones, and he started preaching, there was an identification that came off of that television screen that spoke to my spirit, that said, the church ain't like this now. Okay, I'm not hearing nobody talk to me right there. I said, something is missing in the church because we don't have it like them people got it. Oh, come on here, somebody. We don't have power like that anymore. We can't preach the gospel. Listen, it wasn't no organ behind him. It wasn't no piano playing behind him. It was the gospel of Jesus Christ being preached, the unadulterated gospel, and people were being set free and delivered. Something is wrong, Saint. Something is wrong. And that's when God told me, he said, for the year of 2007, you got to preach holiness if they don't like it. You got to preach righteousness if everybody leave them. This is a Holy Ghost sanctified, purified church. Touch somebody and tell somebody this ain't no Christian center. Well, y'all ain't hearing what I'm saying. Y'all, sit down because y'all don't want to hear that no way. Sit down. I said, tell your neighbor this ain't no Christian center. I said, tell your neighbor this ain't no Christian center. This a sanctified church. This a Holy Ghost filled church. We believe in doing it right. Tell your neighbor if you gonna stay here, you gonna dress right, you gonna look right, you gonna talk right. Come on here, somebody. We gonna look at you and be able to tell you, say, who am I talking to right now? Time to take the guessing game out of it. Y'all sit down. Coming up in here, and we don't know who's saved and who ain't saved. Oh, who am I talking to right there? Because when you get the Holy Ghost, it make you look like you done had a bath. Some of y'all still looking too gray, and I'm not going to stop until you looking like It's too many great saints in the body of Christ. It's because, you know what? We're doing worship for 15 minutes, but you're not pressing through to the presence of God, because it's in his presence that he cleanses, he washes, he purifies you. Y'all sit down. I got to teach this. Sit down. Jesus. Me and Bishop sat at that table, and we were both just overwhelmed. And Bishop pulled out his notepad, and both of us was literally overwhelmed to just about tears. And he looked at me and he said, "That just did something to me." And I said to him, "We just can't be another church." I'm not hearing y'all talk to me. I said, "We just can't be another church. We got to have an identification. We got to be the church that the people said, if you ain't going to live right, don't go over there, honey, because they ain't playing God over there." Oh, I'm not hearing nobody talk to me right there. Is that the kind of church you want? Because that's the kind of church it's going to be. We got to be the kind of church that said, "Baby, honey, listen, but child, they pray all night over there. Honey, they get up at 5 o'clock in the morning and pray. Baby, if you need a breakthrough, you find somebody from Global Destiny, because some people will pray you through. They will cast the devil out of you. It is time for us to come." People are coming to church bound up, and they are going home bound up. But tonight I declare war. Tonight I declare it in the spirit realm that we will be a house of deliverance, the house of a breakthrough, the house to overcome. Sit down, sit down. I don't want to get ahead of myself. I got a long way to go. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Clap your hands and thank him. Come on here. This ain't no entertainment center. You better get used to this. Because when the praise team get up and say, "Clap your hands," you better start clapping. Clap your hands and open your mouth and start telling God thank you. Now, y'all don't hear me. Sit down, because I ain't through yet. Sit down. Sit down. Sit down. Because the Bible said there arose a generation that knew not the Lord. I'm not hearing y'all talk back to me. I said, the Bible said there arose a generation that knew not the Lord. I don't think y'all heard what I said. There arose a generation that knew not the Lord. So when I tell you to praise God, I'm trying to teach you how to know the Lord. When I tell you to holler out of your belly, don't sit there and look at me, because you can look around you. We need your seat. And we ain't having nobody else coming up in here thinking you cute. Well, go on out of here, because you know what? A breakthrough has got to happen in every service. That's the reason why you feel the anointing getting greater, because God is shifting the atmosphere. He's shifting. He's shifting. He's taking us to another level. Y'all sit down. Let me finish this. Let me finish this right quick. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, have mercy. Somebody say everything. Somebody say everything. No, I can't play no games with it. Everything and everybody. I said it's time for all of us to go to another level. Our young people. Oh, y'all ain't saying nothing. Can't get nobody to talk to me right there. Can't get nobody to talk to me right there. I told you I ain't got time for no feelings. And that's why I called Regina up here, because I didn't feel nothing on y'all. I love y'all. Y'all know I love y'all. You know I love you. You know I love you. But I don't feel no weight on y'all. And I'm tired of y'all looking like y'all playing church when it come down to worship. Listen, every song ought to get people into the presence of the Lord. I don't care if it is a fast song. You ought to sing it to everybody falling out. And as long as you can stand there and sing a fast song and nobody's moved, and I'm standing back there in the office and I'm looking on the monitor and people ain't stunting you, there is something wrong with the level that's in your life. That's why I called Regina, because I'm sick and tired of it. We've got to take this church to another level. We got to take this church to a level of power. It's got to go to a level of deliverance. Somebody tell him yes. Somebody tell him yes. We're going with you or without you, but we got to go. Somebody holler out of your belly in here. sit down. Glory to God. Glory to God. You know I love you. Glory to God. You know I love you, don't you? Glory to God. Y'all know I love you, don't you? But we would rather not have a musician. We ain't gonna have no lying homemongering musicians. We're not gonna have no homosexual. All of y'all, some of y'all young ladies that's working these cameras and stuff, you better watch your spirit and get your spirit purified, because too many of y'all looking like boys and pimping, and God is coming against every lesbian spirit, every homosexual spirit in the name of Jesus. I cancel it out now. He got it up on Sunday. We rather not have you operate a camera if you can't live holy. Somebody said the girls in here gonna be girls, and the men gonna be men, and we not gonna be confused about what you look like. Hold up, Oshata Mahaya, Peter Bashanda Mahaya. You better put your spirit on the altar in 2007, because when I walk by some of y'all, I can pick it up. I can pick up the lust on you. I can pick it up on you, and God ain't pleased with it, and He's holding me accountable. He's holding me accountable. He's holding me accountable, and I gotta cry loud. I can't think about your feelings. Sit down, let me finish. Sit down, let me finish. Glory to God. 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 God, we want you in our spirit. God, we want you in our belly. God, we gotta have another level in this house. God, we say yes to your will. God, we say yes to your way. Come on, somebody, for the next 30 seconds, just begin to cry out to him. It's time for you to get a hold of your Shunda. Thank you, Jesus. Sit down, let me finish this. Let me finish this. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. We gonna live it. We gonna live it, Deacon. We gonna live it if we ain't got but five people in here. Hallelujah. 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 We're going to live it if we ain't got but 10. You ain't got to come back if you don't want to. But we're going to live it in here because it can be lived. I don't, y'all ain't hear what I'm saying here. We're going to walk in it because it can be walked in. Who am I talking to right there? You're going to walk in deliverance because deliverance is real. You're going to walk in victory in your life because victory is lived. You're going to be able to walk according to the word because it's real. The Bible said that the power of God and the word of God has the power, that if it is rooted in your spirit, it has the power to set you free. Touch somebody and say, after tonight, you are without excuse. If you're not delivered, it's because you don't have the word and you don't have the nature of God. Sit down, let me read this. Let me read this. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Go to Galatians 5. Hoba shata. Horiandare de Dioshaya. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. Glory to God. People in the overflow room, tell him glory to God. I said, people in the overflow room, tell him glory to God. Glory to your high name, Jesus. Galatians 5 says, I want you to get this. Galatians 5 says here in the 22nd verse, 5 and 22 says, and I'm closing with this, but the fruit, somebody said the fruit, my God. But the fruit of the Holy Spirit. What Holy Spirit am I talking about? The one that I just talked about when it says that it is the divine nature of God. Romans 1 said it is the spirit of holiness, which is the divine nature of God. God's nature is the spirit of holiness. And this one right here, the fruit that this one produces. Jesus, can we just teach this down? It says, but the fruit of the Holy Spirit, the work which his presence within accomplishes. Okay, that right there. The work which his presence within you, elder, accomplishes. That's a problem right there. That's a problem right there. This is a spirit that can only operate within. Because the responsibility of this spirit is to produce something within you. Let me just read this right here. I'll read this right here and I'm through. It says here that, but the fruit of the Holy Spirit, the work which his presence within accomplishes, is love, joy, gladness, peace, patience, an even temper, forbearance, kindness, goodness, benevolence, faithfulness, gentleness, meekness, humility, self-control, self-restraint, continence. Against such things, there is no law that can bring a charge. What am I trying to say right there? Well, I want to take you, Hummer. Go here. Go here. I want to show you something. Go to 1 John 3 and 9. 1 John 3 and 9. I told my husband today, I said, I think I'm coming down with the flu. We're going to preach with the flu. I done preached with pneumonia. Devil didn't want us to get this. Because he wants us to keep on shouting. And we ain't got nothing. I ain't hear nobody talk to me. See, because I've been patient. I waited a whole year. I've been patient. I've just been kind of just watching. I ain't been really saying nothing. Just doing 5 a.m. prayer and just watching. Just watching. And then the Lord just starts saying to me, okay, this ain't no circus. It's time to start cutting the cancer out now. I hear nobody talk to me. He said, it's time to find the real church among all the visitors who have their name on the roll. Because some of y'all got your name on the roll, but you visiting because you ain't going to stay here. I'm not hearing y'all talk to me. Lord have mercy. Lord have mercy. Lord have mercy. See, one thing I'm glad about, and that is me and my husband don't have no crowd pleaser spirit. I'm not hearing nobody talk. God, listen, God been done birthed that out of both of us. We ain't got no question. Listen, we will go next door over in the red little section where them kids have churches, and we'll break all this down. Y'all ain't saying nothing. You're not talking to me because we're not trying to grow a big church. We're trying to get some people purified and some people that love God for real. Oh, Jesus. I want you to hear this. 1 John 3, 1 John 3:9-10. Who got an Amplified Bible? Read that out loud. When I count to three, read the ninth verse. 1, 2, 3. Read it. Okay, y'all, now some of y'all may not have heard what they say. Some of y'all didn't hear what they said. Said, no one that is born of God deliberately or habitually practices sin. Okay, well, I'm just sorry, it's just a habit. No one born of God deliberately or habitually practices sin. Or you're not born again. I'm not hearing y'all talk to me right there. See, I'm going to tell you what my job is in 2007 is to go around the body of Christ and erase all the gray shades. Because a lot of stuff that we call and save is not saved. I'm not hearing y'all talk to me right there. Everybody quiet. Everybody quiet. You cannot habitually and deliberately practice sin and say you saved. You can do stuff and you don't have no conscience. You're not convicted about nothing. Some of y'all sitting right here will tell a lie in a minute and you don't feel nothing. I'm not hearing y'all talk back to me. See, right now we're just getting all quiet because, you know, we just used to putting Band-Aids on stuff and just people coming to church and just, you know, we just mill over messages and, you know, and lost in the forest and stay out the boat and get out the boat and don't stay in the boat and broke, making it on broken pieces. But we're not building people's lives. Oh, God, I wish I had somebody. We don't have nobody to tell us that that's wrong and you can't do that and you can't touch that and you can't keep doing that and saying that you say it is not all right that you do that. We have not created the kind of atmosphere in the sanctuary that the sinner man come to church and feel convicted. God, who am I talking about today? We have not created the kind of atmosphere that a sinner cannot sit in my service and not desire to know Jesus. Who am I talking about? That's what's got to happen in here. We can't let people walk in here in darkness, sit in what we call the light, and they walk back out in darkness. Because you know what? Because we're so busy trying to get people rich. And we're so busy. I'm not. We're so busy trying to make you feel good, trying to keep you encouraged. Oh, Jesus. Okay, let me read something to you right quick, and I'm going to show you. I'm going to show you something. I'm going to show you something. It says here. I got to take you to one more place before I quit. No one born, begotten of God, deliberately, knowingly, and habitually practices sin. For God's nature abides in him. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Y'all read that right there. For God's what?
Nature.
Read that whole thing again. No one what? Stop right there. Read it with me. No one born, begotten of God, deliberately, knowingly, and habitually practices sin. For God's nature abides in him. His principle of life, the divine sperm, remains permanently within him. I'm not hearing y'all. Now that right there. Oh, Jesus. Okay, let me just go here for a second. Let me go here for a second. Now this right here is powerful. Let me go here for a second. Ooh, Jesus. The Bible says that when the word of God is planted and it takes root, it brings forth, it produces growth. Son, you know what I'm talking about. So the reason why is because the word of God is planted And the divine sperm, when it is put in the womb and it hits an egg, it remains in him. When the fullness of the development of that thing has come, then it will be delivered out of you. That's when I don't lie no more on the outside. The word told me I don't lie no more. The sperm of the Lord is in me. It is now incubating and growing and producing a non-lying spirit. Okay. The mother has an egg. The father puts the sperm in, and it is producing a living child that you will one day give birth to in 9 months. I'm not hearing y'all talk to me. Somebody, are you lost at what I'm trying to say? Then why are you not producing? If the sperm went in, the word is there. Why are you not producing? Why has it been 5 years and you still a liar? This ain't no New Year's message. I'm messing up. Y'all act like I wrote this. I didn't make this up. It's in the Bible. It's in the Bible. All right. We go. I'm just going to close up because some of y'all. Yeah. It says, for God's nature abides in him. His principle of life. Not the way that seemeth right to a man, but the end of that way is destruction. His principle of life. His, sweetheart, his, not the one that people tell you that it's all right. His principle of life, not the one that said, I know you shacking with him and it's all right, because one day, no, his principle of life, because when, okay. It says, for God's nature abides in him, his principle of life, the divine sperm remains, how long? No, I said how long? Say it again. Where? And he cannot what? He cannot practice sitting because he is born begotten of God. When the divine sperm goes in, it stays in permanently. Therefore, you can't practice. Not I don't want to. I can't even if I want to. That's what we don't have. We don't have the I can't. We have the I want to, so I did. We don't have the I can't. The I can't says, the divine sperm is permanently in me, therefore I can't practice that. I can't. Y'all ain't saying nothing. I'm just... Lord, have mercy, Jesus. Father, you're going to help us tonight. I can't do that. That's what I want to plant in you when 12 o'clock strike tonight. A spirit that says, I can't. I can't no more. A spirit that will make you go home and clean it all out and say, I can't no more. I can't. I'm going to get the pornography books. I'm going to get the magazines. I can't no more. Who am I talking to? Because see, y'all looking at me like, I'm not having nobody talk to me right there. I'm not hearing nobody talk back to me right there. I can't do it. I want to do it, but I can't. Something happened to me tonight in church when the new year came in. Something, the power of God hit my belly, and I just can't do stuff like that no more. I can't talk like that no more. I can't sit in that kind of company. I can't gossip no more. I can't lie no more. I can't hear that kind of mess. I don't want to be with you. It's something about your spirit. Now that God is in me, I can pick up something foul about you. I don't want to be with you. I can't no more. Nobody talk to me right there. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I stand in the back and I'm watching the monitors. And I get through with 5 a.m. prayer. I don't leave right out. I sit back there alone time. And I just watch the camera. And the Lord just talked to me. He said, ain't any bellies yet. They still being entertained. They still high because you and Bishop is here. It ain't a breakthrough yet. I'm not hearing y'all talk to me. Oh, Lord, have mercy. You know, there's a level on people when they praise God, when you know that God is birthing something out in them. There's just something in them that comes out when they praise God. They praise sound different. I'm not hearing y'all talk to me. And see, that's my job. That's my job in 2007, to get your praise out of your belly. Not out of your mouth, but out of your belly. Oh, God, I'm not here. Because your belly have been sanctified. Because your belly have become acquainted with him. Because now you're one with him in the spirit. I'm not hearing y'all talk back to me. I'm not hearing y'all talk back to me. I wish I had somebody to say something right there. That when you yelling because the spirit of the Lord done found something in you that's unrighteous and you glad about it. You ain't sitting here mad because I'm preaching on sin. You are, oh, my God. You thanking God because you done found a place where somebody is coming after your soul. Somebody don't want you to be lost. I'm not talking about your offering. I'm not talking about your talent. I want you to make it in the kingdom. I want you to be saved for real. So that's why you ought to holler every time somebody name your sin. You ought to say, it's me, God. She talking to me. I bless your name. Let me read this to you. Sit down for a minute. Sit down for a minute. Let me read this to you. Lord, have mercy. Woo, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I just kept hearing the Lord say today that you ain't found no real church until they shout when you hit their mess, until they praise God when you name their sin. Who am I talking to right there? Somebody just begin to give him a shout. Somebody begin to give him a shout. Somebody begin to give him a shout. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, give him a shout in here. Shout. Come on, tell him, God, in 2007, dig me out. Dig me out. Dig out my spirit. Go after every hidden place. Go after every hidden sin. God, purge me with his. Sit down. Let me read this to you, and I got to go. Lord Jesus, when I read this, Lord Jesus, no one born. My God, my God. See, somebody said, when you come here, and I was talking to the Lord today, one more thing for your New Year's resolution. You got three. This is the fourth thing. This is the fourth thing. Said, this is the year that God finds the ugly in me. This is the year. This is the year that he locates the ugly in me. Oh, my God. See, people don't have New Year's resolutions like this. That's why we. This is the year that he digs it out. This is the year that he locates everything in me that's wrong. This is the year that he exposes it. Oh, y'all ain't hearing me right now. I just wish I had somebody talk to me right there. I just wish I had somebody talk to me right there. I wish I had somebody talk back to me right there, because y'all look like y'all don't want this. No, this is the year that he allows you to confront stuff about you that you didn't even know that was about you. This is the year that you stop complaining that everybody don't like you and you find out why they don't like you. Because you mean, and because you ugly, and because you self-righteous, and because you arrogant, and because you condescending. I'm not hearing nobody talk to me. God, we're going to be saved. I said, we're going to be saved this year. I just want somebody to go with me because I'm going, 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 I'm going. Because see, it's like, you know what, this kind of message is like when Paul and them were stuck out and they had Paul as a prisoner and they all got in the boat. Y'all remember that story? They got in the boat and when the turbulent winds came, some of them tried to sneak off on another boat. And God gave Paul a word and said, the only way y'all gonna be saved is everybody stay in this boat. Don't nobody try to jump and sneak off. Because when it got heavy, everybody started trying to sneak off on a little side boat and crawl out. But you ain't gonna be able to get away. If you don't never come at the global destiny, you're not gonna be able to get away, because now it has been pronounced over your life as a prophet that this would be the year that he would dig you out. This would be the year that he would expose your ugliness. This would be the year that he would purify you. So this year, instead of amen, we would be saying, that's me. That's me, Lord. The man of God is talking to me, Lord. Let me just read this one scripture and I'm closing for this segment of it. Go to Job. Go to Job 33. Hayabo shata mahaya. Well, everything got to change. We got to change our songs. Because y'all got to sing songs that convict you while you sing them. I ain't hear nobody talk to me. I ain't hear nobody talk to me. I'm telling you, God's dealing with me. I ain't got time for all this stuff. Young people, too many jumpy songs. Too many jumpy songs. Find you some songs that's gonna cause y'all to press into God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Y'all don't like me tonight. It's okay. It's okay. It's okay. Too many of the same songs. I'm tired of hearing the same songs. Tired of hearing the same songs. We can't get nowhere in God. You feeding us old manna. We don't want that. We had it last Sunday. We don't want to hear that no more. We want something different. We want another level. We want you to teach us what God has broken your spirit. Somebody begin to praise him right there. Somebody praise him right there. Come on, the Holy Ghost is setting the house in order. Begin to praise him. Praise him in the overflow room. Praise him. Praise him in the overflow room. God's really getting ready to use you in worship. I know you sing fast songs, but I hear you in worship. Glory to God. Another level. Hey, yeah. Here I am.
That's what I'm talking about. We can't be up here playing and worship. We sing too many fast songs. Because that's praise. And you can live any kind of way and praise it. But they that worship the Lord must worship him in spirit and in truth. Take the people into the presence of the Lord. Into the presence of the Lord. I'm not through with this. Gotta read this right quick before I take the offering. Some of y'all say, well, how do I know I'm being delivered? Yes, Lord. Save it. He says, save it to the next service. Thank you, Jesus. You pull it out. You've uprooted all week. We got to get ready. We got to get ready for the loss. I hear nobody talk to me right now. I said, we got to get ready for the loss. What you doing up in here? Your relatives ain't saved and they ain't trying to follow you to church. We got to get ready for the loss. We got to pray them out. And they got to look at you and know you done took a bath. They got to be able to look at your countenance and say, something done happened to you. I'm going to your church next Sunday. Oh God, come on somebody. We might as well close up. Because church now is big business. And I hear nobody talk to me right now. I didn't get nobody to say amen. I must be scared to say amen. Thank you, Jesus. I'm not through with this by a long shot. Everybody in this building, God is doing something in this place. And you in this building, there's two things I have to do. You'll be in this building and you want to become a part of the Global Destiny family. I know that's a real big thing for me to ask that I done beat the devil at you, but I don't care. Because I believe somebody want to be saved. I was raised up in the church with a life raft. You do your dirt out there, but when you walked in church, you felt an anchor for your soul. You felt some church mothers was praying. You felt like you had somebody to run to. Oh, come on here, somebody. You in this building today, and you said, I want to be a part of the Global Destiny family. If you in the overflow room, you ain't down the street, we're going to wait for you. If you in the overflow room, come out the overflow room. If you in this building right now, you can come up here so I can pray for you. Because we're going to the next level in God. And move quick, because we're not going to wait. Come line up right here. I want to be a part of this ministry. God, do something in my life. Come over here. Come over here. Y'all just come on over here. Thank you, Jesus. Somebody bless God in this place. You coming to join? Because what you're saying is, I'm tired of living wrong. I'm tired of living shady. Prophetess, I want to be saved for real. If that ain't what you're saying in this line, then go and get out the line, because we don't have no more room. We don't have no more room for bodies. Bishop trying to move us now to another building because we ain't got no more space. So we ain't got no more room for just bodies. We need soldiers. We need people that we can send to hospitals and pray for the sick. We need people we can send to nursing homes. We need people we can send to crack houses. We need people we can send to Africa. We don't need nobody else. We got to babysit and keep making you put stuff down every week. Got no time to be breaking up no more fights, no more in-house fights. She did this. She hurt my feelings. Suck it up and get over it. It's about kingdom. 2007 is kingdom. Said 2007 is kingdom. Tell them it ain't your feelings. And tell them as long as you work in the kingdom, you're going to get your feelings hurt anyway. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Everybody in this building. Everybody in this building that's got a $27 seat on you anywhere, I want you to get it in your hand right now. That's what I feel impressed of the Lord for you all to sow in this service. And if you're going to do it and be obedient, I want you to do it quickly. We praying for everything. I'm going to tell you, y'all going to see God turn your finances around. You're going to see God turn your work life around. You're going to see God turn your living quarters around. And why? Because you're going to get holy. And you're going to live right. And prosperity is going to gravitate to the righteous.
And that's how you're going to tell people right in this body they ain't living right, because they're going to stay raggedy and poor and depressed. Because 2007 is the year of the righteous. Tell your neighbor that 2007 is the year of the righteous. It's the year of the people that do right. Thank you, Jesus. 2007 is the recompense of the righteous. Lord, I love that. God, I just felt that. It's the recompense of the righteous. It's for us who've been waiting in righteousness for a long time. The Lord said 2007 is our due season. No, y'all better come on and bless it. See, everybody can't praise the Lord because, you know, this is only the people that's been living right. 2007 is our recompense. Is our recompense. Get that seed in your hand. Everybody get a seed in your hand. Get that $27 seed in your hand. Do it now. Do it now. Do it now. In the overflow room. Get your seed offering. Every person in the overflow room has got a $27 seed on you. Be obedient and do it now. The Lord knows why he asked me to have you to give that seed. 2007 is the year of the righteous. Lord, I love you. It's the year of the righteous. Everybody in this line, I want you to turn around and join hands. Join hands. Join hands. Is they finished coming from the overflow room before I start praying? Where's my ushers? Are y'all ready for these people? Are y'all ready to take them where y'all supposed to take them? You ready? Who's in charge of this? Who's in charge? You ready, baby? Somebody ought to bless the Lord. You ought to look at the harvest. I said we ought to bless the Lord. I was telling my husband, I said, the Lord told me that in 2007, I got to preach more in this house, more than 5 a.m. Because now we're establishing the face of our church. We're putting the face on it. Amen, somebody. We ain't getting ready to be shady. You're going to be able to look at us and don't know where we at. Amen, somebody. You're going to open your mouth and people are going to say you belong to global destiny. Because we people of faith and power. And we people of prayer. That's what I want you to know about yourself. Say that to your neighbor. We people of faith and power, and we're people of prayer. We people of prayer. It's a house of prayer. Some of y'all who ain't been coming to the 5 a.m. prayer and you can't make it, that's all right. We're going to have one for you too. Amen, somebody. Amen, somebody. We ain't going to have no excuses. Well, I couldn't get up at 5 o'clock in the morning. All right, we're going to create another hour for you in another day. But if you're going to be a part of this ministry, you're going to come to prayer. Get your seed offering in your hand. Where's my ushers? Because we can do this at the same time. I want you to pass your offering. Everybody in this section, sit down so you all can see, so they can know what I'm talking about. Sit down so you can see. Everybody's got a seed offering in your hand, raise your hand up. I want to see your seed offering. You got a seed offering. If you don't have $27, give God a $10 seed. Give him a seed of expectancy. That's how the Jews do. They give God at the end of the year what they're expecting for God to do. We're the only ones still lagging behind. I ain't lagging. I've already prophesied my seed. Amen, somebody. They give a tithe of what they expect for God to do for the rest of the year. Amen, somebody. Everybody over in this section right here, even in this aisle right here, over on the across yours, across the aisle, and pass it down this way. Everybody that's in this section right here, pass yours this way. The people that's here and the people that's here, pass yours to the end of the aisle that way, and yours come this way, and the usher's going down the aisle.